seconds there. Let's have a good one, everybody.
Stand by, all cameras. Ready, slow-mo. Stand by, videotape.
All set, Howard? Okay, Frank.
And roll tape. 4, 3,
nice and loose,
2, 1. Take tape.
Is by order of the Federation Energy Commission. All citizens of sectors R, Zone 2, will report to the Regional Energy Headquarters for their BTU ration coupons. All citizens will confine living areas to 2 rooms per dwelling. All buildings not registered for multiple dwellings are declared condemned.
This is our future. Unless we form a plan of action to find a more efficient means of providing human comfort without wasting natural resources, hydronics is an answer. Because no matter what energy sources may be in long or short supply, a hydronic system installed today can adapt to any fuel tomorrow. Hydronics, the ideal heating and cooling system of today for tomorrow. For more information, write Hydronics, 2501 Bell, Des Moines, Iowa.
Okay, I think we're live. All right, looks like my audio is working. Hope you all enjoyed that little thing there. Still on a countdown. Oh, okay. I don't know. Yeah, you may, if you had to refresh the stream or refresh the Twitch page, you might be lagging a bit, or like you just might be a few seconds behind everyone else. It actually doesn't matter because we're not trying to do things super synchronously, but hopefully that is working and hopefully you all can see and hear me. I can see many of you online, both in Discord and in Twitch, so this is good. Seems like it's working, but if you're having an issue, let me know. Otherwise, you know, we'll get started. So actually, I usually kind of chatter for a bit as people are coming online, but I have a lot I want to try to get to today, so I'm going to jump straight into it pretty much. Why is she going in and out? I actually have like an elaborate setup here on my desk, so it's a little awkward right now because I don't have a document camera at home, but I sort of rigged something up that'll kind of work as a document camera, and I did want to show you something. I also have an actual like slideshow that I made about Winsor McCay, and that will be something that I can share with you. So if you want to look at some of these things later, you can have access to it. In fact, maybe I'll go ahead and do that. I'll share it in Discord, and then you can just kind of look through it as I'm talking. If you want to look at it on your own, you'll probably be able to see it better on your own screen as opposed to watching it over the stream. So let me change the link and view, copy link, okay. And I'll share this in Discord. Here's a slideshow I'm going to be okay. So there you go. So you can have that for future reference if you want, or just to follow along on your own and kind of click through it on your own as you want to as we talk through things. So today we are going to continue talking about Crazy Cat and Winsor McCay, or I guess I am. I mean, you can type about them, but I'm going to be doing all the talking as we've been doing. That's our modality for now, but we will be trying other modalities. I'm also going to, no, I don't have much to say about the next reading yet. I don't have a link ready for you yet, but I can say a little bit about the next reading, which will be The City by Franz Masriel. This is unrelated. Sorry, I was looking for a specific picture in my Instagram archive and I found it. So I wanted to start off with a couple of thoughts about Crazy Cat and kind of look back at a few of the comments some of you were making in Discord. So this is my little makeshift, my little document camera that I set up. It's literally a webcam duct taped to a piece of wood and pointed at the table here. So it's kind of weirdly zoomed in. But what I have here, let me show you what I have. If I can close it without hitting the camera. Okay, so this is a book that is from our library. And Serena, can you close that door all the way when you get a chance?
Sure.
And this is, it's a Crazy Cat collection. And it is, this one is, if I can turn the pages, it's kind of old, so I'm trying to be really careful here. So this is actually, it's an anthology, basically, and it's introduced by E.E. Cummings, the poet, the famous American poet. It just kind of illustrates how George Harriman and Crazy Cat were received by kind of the literary establishment. And he talks here in the introduction, he even references the fact that there's plenty of other tributes and recognitions of Crazy Cat. So I don't know what else I have to add to it. But he does have some, E.E. Cummings does have some really interesting descriptions of these. He almost does this kind of Freudian analysis of the whole scenario that's presented in here. Cecily, why do you keep coming in and out? Can you use the other door, please? Because that's making a lot of noise. Okay. And she slams that one. Okay. So there's this, so I don't know if you can, you probably can't read it, but it's, he's talking about how Officer Pup and Ignatz are really at each other. So they are the, but they are each other's opposite. And so he describes the mouse, yeah, so he describes Ignatz as the egoist mouse and Officer Pup as the altruist dog. He reflects on Crazy Cat's gender ambiguity here. I think it's really interesting. So in this part, E. Cummings, and I can't adjust the focus of this, unfortunately, so that's a one limitation, and I also don't have a way of illuminating part of it, but anyway, I'll just read it to you. What it's saying here is the hero and the villain. So that's what he's arguing is that Ignatz and Pup are either hero. One is the hero, one is the villain. But which is which depends on your worldview. And I think that's pretty interesting. But he says the hero and the villain no more understand Crazy Cat than the mythical denizens of a two-dimensional realm understand some three-dimensional intruder. The world of Officer Pup and Ignatz Mouse is a knowledgeable power world in terms of which our unknowledgeable heroine is powerlessness personified. So basically she, and here, even though E. Cummings notes the gender ambiguity, he consistently uses the feminine pronouns for Crazy Cat. So basically saying that Crazy Cat is on some other dimensional plane. Like, Crazy Cat is some other kind of being, and so it doesn't fit into the hero-villain scenario that Ignatz and Officer Pup have, which is, that's the typical kind of cat-and-mouse scenario of a funny animal strip, is that antagonism that exists between Pup and Ignatz. But but Crazy Cat is somewhere else. So Crazy Cat just kind of exists. And the thing about Crazy is love. And I really like this bit down here. So going on the idea of the egoist, the hard-headed egoist, which is Ignatz. She is to our soft-headed altruist, that's Officer Pup, she is the adorably helpless incarnation of saintliness. To our hard-hearted egoist, she is the puzzlingly indestructible embodiment of idiocy. The benevolent overdog sees her as an inspired weakling. The malevolent undermouse views her as a born target. Meanwhile, Crazy Cat, through this double misunderstanding, fulfills her joyous destiny. I love that. Let's make no mistake about Crazy. A lot of people love because, and a lot of people love although, and a few individuals love. Love is something illimitable. And a lot of people spend their limited lives trying to prevent anything illimitable from happening to them. Crazy, however, is not a lot of people. Crazy is herself. Crazy is illimitable. She loves. She loves in the only way, and some samples here, anyone can love illimitably. And it goes on. It's really a beautiful essay. And it's fascinating that it's so so literary in its writing. And E. Cummings, of course, the poet, knows what he's talking about in terms of literariness and poetry. So I wanted to share that. I got this from our library because I was hoping it was going to be the full color, book, but it's not. But it's almost more interesting because it is itself an artifact. Like, it's This was published in 1946, just after the strip ended, so it was really kind of a celebration. And we see that this kind of celebration now, like, you know, Garfield anthologies or whatever. But the what is going on here? But this was a new thing for comics to be appreciated this way by literary critics, with this much fanfare. And it's not just saying this is a great comic. Like, it really, as you see here, gets into E. Cummings really explains and critiques and gives us his analysis of it, which I think is really useful and interesting. So this is our library's book. I will return it soon, so if you want to check it out and if you're curious. A lot of you seem to really like Crazy Cat, so if you want to learn more about Crazy Cat, this might be a good way to do it. I'm going to see if I can get a copy of one of the full-color ones, and then I will share that and maybe make it available for you to borrow if you want later on, too. So I just noticed my audio is a little bit out of sync, but hopefully that's not too distracting. I'll try not to, you know, not... It doesn't matter. Okay. So let's see, I have not had anything up here. Yeah, if you're watching it, if the stream is slow, Piper, it might be because I was piping two different video feeds in there, and so just that amount of bandwidth that would need might have been a lot, so it might calm down now. We'll see, and it might get bad again later by the time I get the... Oh, it looks like Poofaloof is still having trouble. So, let's see. Okay, sorry, there's a bit of a side conversation going on in here, so let me see if I can help. If you can't see me, then I can't really say much about it. But, yeah, that's really frustrating if you can't watch it online. Let me see, maybe I can actually change the stream setting, the quality. Well, it's set on 720. Okay, looks like you're here. Okay, great. Hopefully it works. Hopefully that continues to work for you. Okay, well, I'm going to keep going. And if you do have issues, of course, you can watch this later archived. Obviously, that's not as great, but it's better than nothing, I suppose. And as some of you have noted here, yeah, we are actually, I guess the president put out a video yesterday, we are actually going to be going face-to-face in a couple weeks, or week after next. So, yeah, that's, I don't know, we'll see how that goes. I think it'll go fine. I'm pretty confident in the preparations. I've been on campus, and it looks like physically the campus space looks very well prepared. There's hand sanitizers everywhere. Basically every door has a hand sanitizer next to it. There's markings on the floors and stuff. It looks like a well-prepared space. So I think if any university can do this safely, I think UMW can, and I think we're ready. That said, as this has come out, like, if you remember, one of the things I was asking you in that information survey, the welcome survey, I wanted to know if you plan to come back or not if we do go to face-to-face. Most of you said you were planning to. So if that changes, please let me know, because I still need to figure out groups based on who's going to be present physically and who's not. So if you've changed your mind, like, to me, honestly, as I'm thinking about it, I am a little bit more nervous now that I know we're actually doing it. I know it'll be fine, but now that I'm actually thinking through, like, what those days of class are going to be like, I am a little bit more nervous about it. So if you are also reconsidering or whatever, just let me know if you want to switch to the online-only cohort so that I can put more people there. So, because right now there's only two people in that cohort, technically. Okay, great. So, also wanted to mention a couple of you had I enjoyed the discussion in Discord, especially those of you talking about some of the Little Nemo strips, which are indeed pretty weird. And, you know, weirdness is interesting to me, so I like the weirdness. Some of them are kind of disturbing, honestly, and like genuinely disturbing, not just like in an ironically, let's call these things disturbing kind of way, but like in a really, like, these are really, like, they can really stick with you. So let me just talk about a couple of these, and then I'll go into the kind of historical stuff a little bit. Yoshi Player, you noted the kaiju turkey is pretty funny. I think it's pretty interesting too how this layout, like the big circle in the middle, if you look at the numbers, it's kind of interesting. So you can look at it, this is back when he was still numbering each panel, and that gradually goes away. But you can kind of see how you need a roadmap for a comic like this. So it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then it goes down to 6, up to 7 in the middle, then 8 top right, and then 9. So it kind of makes a backwards N shape. So that's, you know, that's nice. But then you can almost see him, like, continuing the same idea with next week's page, where he's still thinking about the idea of a big round panel in the middle, but the order is actually different here. So now we go 5 on the top left, 6 on the top right, 7 on the bottom left, and then 8, and then 9 across the middle. So it almost like it's like jump, and then Jen does like a little M thing, or I guess W. But yeah, then you get this big weird moon face thing in the middle. I always think it looks like Ed Asner, the actor. These yellow guys. Just at a basic level, even when it's very clear what McKay's doing, like this, you know, there's nothing really secret about this particular story. It's very straightforward, I guess. Just the artwork is so intensely weird and intensely so vivid and almost visceral that it can be, even on a relatively benign strip like this one, it can be like, what's going on here? It can really stick with you visually. And I think that's because of that, surrealist intensity that gives us pause when we're looking at other strips that are disturbing in different ways. A couple of you mentioned this one, and this one definitely, like this one always comes up whenever we talk about this in class. Like this is one that is, it can be really haunting just visually because of the intensity of the expression of these glass soldiers, as you know, and then their bodies are sort of breaking up and like they're moaning. But the basic plot here, as some of you point out, is also pretty weird. I mean, pretty disturbing. Like this is a kid. This is little Nemo. He is 5 years old at this point, by the way. It establishes later on that he is aging with the century. So he was born in 1900. So he's 5 years old. Here's this glass princess, and all he knows about her is that she's beautiful and he's not supposed to touch her. But in this panel, which is interestingly, let me zoom in on this one so you can see what I'm talking about better. This panel down here, up until now there's all this dialogue, right? There's this, all the people are saying, don't touch her, whatever. And then in this panel, all of a sudden there's no dialogue. There's just kind of like shocking moment of realization of what he's done. And as he's reaching for her, her body starts falling apart. His lust has actually destroyed her in this like assault. It's really weird. And I think, you know, it's difficult to know what to make of this. Like, I don't think that Winsor McCay does this as like a joke. I don't think he views this as a kind of social commentary, although I think you could look at this as a critique of a sexual assault, or like a parody of it, or some satire, something like that, to make people aware of like the harm of assault. But I don't think that's really what's going on. I think it's really just something that he thought was a disturbing kind of story and a nightmare, basically. And this is a nightmare. Several Little Nemo pages are like, some of them are like whimsical, enchanting dreams, but I would say probably half of them are like disturbing nightmares. And it's interesting that this was run in the funny pages, the comic pages. And maybe that's why it never had a huge audience among children. It was something that adults enjoyed, and people like Randolph Hearst enjoyed, literary, you know, critics and art critics enjoyed it and admired it for its artistry. And you can see definitely like just the skill and the expression that goes into this is extraordinary. And so there's lots to appreciate about this as an artistic artifact. But narratively, it was always very weak, I think. Just the stories are really not, very little happens. It's more like McKay has these ideas for things to draw, and then sort of creates this very flimsy narrative of Little Nemo trying to get to Slumberland, or and having various things that prevent him from getting there over and over and over again. And it's not very compelling as a story, but it gives occasion for these really gorgeous images, and layouts, experimental panels. Some of these are like, this one's fairly conventional, I think, lots of rectangles. I'm just kind of clicking through here. Here's where we see his age established. This one, I think someone else noticed, this one is also pretty disturbing. This is one of several where Nemo was essentially killed at the end and wakes up in bed. And this is, he's shot full of arrows. Also, you see a racial caricature there, like I mentioned. Animals, I think, end up being drawn really well throughout this. Yeah, so I recommend this one. I find really funny. I don't know. I'm not really sure what's going on here, but he's just like flipping around with his uncle, and dear old Uncle Alex came through the room on his way to the gymnasium. He didn't understand how easy one could be mistaken. Let me zoom in on this. I just find this the dialogue here kind of funny. So he's like, "Didn't you ever see your uncle take his exercise?" "No, sir." And he's like lifting weights. "I wish I could do that. It's easy." He's like pumping iron. "Why don't you?" And he says, "It's easy." And then he says, "Why didn't you ever get married? Hey, Uncle Alexander." Look at him working out. Don't ask such a foolish question. He's just like doing gymnastics and ends up falling and then waking up. But yeah, just like, I don't really know what, I think this one's supposed to be more of a joke, but I don't quite get the joke. So I don't know. Let me get in. There's lots of these that are pretty entertaining. This is another one I mentioned actually in Discord, where there's a object of Nemo's attention that turns out to be something else, though, in this case. And this is another one of these nightmares. This girl that he perceives as a girl, he says, "Will you be my Valentine?" And then he's like, "Let's go on this date, I guess." And then it turns out she's made of paper. The idea of being made out of paper is a theme you'll see in a few other Little Nemos, where Little Nemo, of course, is literally made of paper. Like, he's printed in a page. Like, he's a printed in a comic. And sometimes he becomes aware of that. So he is here disturbed by the fact that this girl is a drawing. There are two or three different panel strips later on where Little Nemo discovers that he himself is a drawing. And in one case, it's a really bad drawing. I couldn't find that actual page. It's a bit later, but the world around him is gradually turning into bad drawings, including himself. And you can imagine, like, that's a really horrifying scenario. Like, I could imagine that being like a Twilight Zone episode. Like, it's really creepy. And playing with the edges of the medium to be creepy is something that you see, that you definitely see Winsor McCay doing a lot. So let's take a look at this. I'm going to switch over into a slightly different presentational mode. So let's see. Let me get back on the live stream Discord. He's literally in the story, he's 5 years old, but he's very much acts like an adult most of the time. And then sometimes he acts like a kid. He's not very consistent as a character. And I think that's partly just like Winsor McCay not really making an amazing, the storytelling is really not the strong suit here. Okay, let me switch over to this, and that's not the right one. So let me get my, is that it? Good, okay. So I'm gonna try this mode here. I don't know how well this is gonna work, but this is me with, and I'll put myself back on here. Yeah, here I am. Okay, so I have to recrop this. Does it matter if I'm on this? It might not. I'm gonna just turn myself off. It doesn't matter. Okay, so this is a slideshow, and this is one I linked in here. And I wanted to take you through a few things to talk about Winsor McCay. So 1871 to 1934, interestingly, his birth date is a little bit unclear. So if you look on Wikipedia, for example, it says 1866 or 1871. So I don't know. That's a pretty wide discrepancy. I'm not sure why that was unclear. So this is Little Sammy Sneeze. This is a strip he did for the New York Herald for a couple years. And I showed you this one the other day, but it's the same, the basic premise, the ah. And in this case, everything revolves around a sneeze. Like I said, of Little Nemo, Winsor McCay is not really a masterful storyteller, but he is a masterful artist and a designer of comics. So what we see here is, I think, pretty funny, but it's the Little Sammy Sneeze stories where the identical thing over and over again. So the same thing, different scenarios, but you kind of always know what's going to happen. Maybe it's a kind of a vaudeville sort of skit, like it's a very slapstick kind of joke, I guess. So that's something you'd be used to doing. And McCay did have experience as a vaudeville performer, so he did like quick drawing on stage, and so maybe he was drawing on that tradition. So, but anyway, here's the joke in this one. "Hurry, Papa, it's leaking all over. Here, Sammy, hold this candle a minute. Get hold quick. Just hold that candle still, and I'll turn this water off." "Great Scott," she says. I like how the wife in the background is like panicking, and like the dad's just trying to hold it together. This is, I think, a pretty funny strip. He says, "Ee-ah, it's the parlor is like a lake. Do hurry, turn it off, do hurry. Ee-ah, Tell your mother to have a fit if she wants, but let me alone. The piano is floating out of the window, Papa. Yes, yes, yes. Just wait a second. Don't get excited. Cuh. Chow. Mercy sakes, what's the trouble? And then boot. The last panel is almost always the same, and even the same posture of whoever is kicking Sammy. And Sammy flying kind of towards us. Here's another typical one. So they're at the village blacksmith. I'll tell you you're wrong. I'll tell you why. Hey, boy, you want a job? Brush the flies from this horse. For instance, supposing I'll take this example. So these guys are just kind of having this conversation. Roosevelt, oh, they're talking about politics. And Sammy is about to sneeze and basically destroys the entire house and blasts the two gentlemen. Like, there's one still flying up in the background and the horse is running away. So he's like created this basically explosion. But the same joke and different scenarios. But even in these pretty simple strips, you can see, I think you can see McKay's skill as an artist to be able to draw these horses and their bodies flying through the air. Pretty compelling. Okay, so this is the Dream of the Rabbit Fiend. And like I've said a few times, Winsor McCay is masterful at creating, I guess, nightmarish scenarios and rendering them vividly in comic form. And these aren't really funny. Some of the Rabbit Fiends are kind of funny, I think, and they're meant to be jokes, like the one with the ink blots. But there's some that are just straight up, I mean, literally just nightmares, and this is one. And this is... It's the same thing in the end. Like everyone ends the same way. He wakes the character wakes up having regretting having eaten something, usually rabbit. In this case, this is one where we are seeing from a first person point of view, which is a pretty innovative just visual technique. And in the top left here, you see he's on the surgery table, but it doesn't go well. They declare him dead in the top right, and then now everyone is gathering around. His wife shows up and says, "Oh, why did you die without leaving me even 5 cents? I'm glad you've gone. You led me an awful life. It was coming to you." So, and then the doctor or coroner, maybe, he's saying it's too bad he should go out without some little preparation. And then now he's in his, this is his funeral. He's kind of seeing through this window up through the coffin, and all the pallbearers are basically trash talking him. That booze that he has put away would float a ship. He's heavy, isn't he? And then this guy over here in the background, if you can see, this is his wife, and this man next to her is saying, "Oh, I'll make you forget him. He was no good. He was a brute, Mary. I love you." And she's saying, "I always did think more of you to come to think of it." So she's like, "Oh, yeah." Then the priest says, "Death in this case is a blessing, not only to his wife, but to the whole community. He was absolutely no good." And then they bury him, and you can see the dirt sort of falling on the coffin down here from the first person point of view of being in the coffin, as though there's like a window in it. And then he wakes up and he says, oh, Mary, I'll be good. I'll be good. Oh, shucks. It's a dream. Good. I ate a cheese pie last night. Oh, what a dream. Clearly, there's much more going on here than just a cheese pie and really just a nightmare, like a scenario that some people have specific phobias of. Like the idea of being buried alive is horrifying. To a lot of people, for anybody, but this is Winsor McCay tapping into that anxiety for a comic strip. This is Rarebit. I made this a few years ago. I took this picture a few years ago and I made it. It's really good. I recommend it. This is a link to a recipe. I don't remember if this is the one I followed, but I think it was the one I followed. But it's basically you make a cheese sauce with Worcestershire and cheddar cheese and beer, and then you kind of cook that down, and then you like put that on some toast, and yeah, me too. Arrow 279. It's an intense experience, but Rabbit is good. So it's basically, and then you have like a brown bread toast, and then you put that in the broiler or something, and then you kind of toast it like that and have it with some, you know, nice dark beer, and it's really good. It's a nice snack. I mean, it's not a snack even. It's a good kind of pub food sort of thing. But I recommend it. You know, if you make it, take a picture. Okay, so this is one I think I showed you the other day, where this is where this guy is just kind of like, well, sir, I never dreamed I'd be a pen and ink drawing of a spring fashion for men, but it seems I am. And then he's like, the artist has made a blur in my knee. That's too bad. He can fix it, I guess. And I like this guy's attitude, because he's still, he kind of, he tries to sort of make the best of things, but he also is sort of, I don't know, this opening panel just cracks me up, where he's like, "Well, sir, I never dreamed I'd be a pen and ink drawing of a spring fashion for men, but it seems I am." And then he goes on, and then of course has problems. He, as he notes here, the artist appears to be drunk and is throwing ink everywhere, and so he can barely make it out. So by the end, it is pretty much a nightmare again, and it has a similar kind of claustrophobic feeling as the one being buried, of the guy being buried alive. So this is this is another one that's pretty good. You notice here, McKay signs his name as Silas for these earlier strips. That was a pseudonym he used. Okay, so this one is really rough. I'm not going to zoom in on this one. But I'll just kind of get, and you, but you're welcome to if you want, and you can kind of see how this one goes. This one proceeds differently, almost like an animation. Each panel is relatively small, so you can kind of see it one at a time and then sort of move left to right across the top and then down through here. But if you look at it, and sometimes when I do this in class, I'll actually zoom in so that I can look at one panel at a time and kind of take it step by step, and it really makes everybody squirm. It's really, it's really intense. So, okay, so this is a character who wakes up, and if you look at kind of at a glance, you can see that the person who's having this dream is basically motionless, and it's basically the same drawing for each panel. And so that's why you can kind of think of it as like animation, where it's like a frame by frame animation where he's drawing each of these. But basically, this person is asleep and can't move, but he's awake. The dream is that he's awake but can't move, and all these animals start showing up. This is actually a common sleep phenomenon called sleep paralysis. That's what we're seeing here, and it's something that I have experienced a couple times, and it is not fun, let me tell you. So I did not enjoy it, at least. Many people often dream that when they experience this, they dream that there's something standing on them or some figure watching them from the side of the bed. It is a really terrifying experience, and I think that's what that specific thing is, what McKay is drawing here. But in this case, these animals show up. Let's see, these chickens start pulling like caterpillars out of his nose. These birds start making a nest in his mouth, and another group are making a nest in his ear. This chicken is laying eggs on him. This squirrel, yeah, so he can't breathe because there's a bird nest in his mouth. Let's see, the pig shows up for some reason. Down here, the squirrel starts digging a hole in his chest to bury nuts. And then he wakes up and there's a turtle and there's flies everywhere. It's like a really gross kind of scene. And then, confound that rarebit I ate last night. Wow, I'll never forget this dream if I live a million years. So again, really horrifying. Like, there's no other way to put this. But what's impressive about it is how horrifying it is and how vividly rendered that is, with pretty simple line art, but really detailed line art that's really precise when it comes to, and realistic when it comes to, human and animal forms. And so putting them in this scenario here really is... it really makes you kind of cringe. It's a lot. So I'm going to take that off. Okay, so Little Nemo in Slumberland, also published for a few years under the title In the Land of Wonderful Dreams. And it goes through different eras. If you click on the link here, this takes you over to the comic strip library. In fact, I'll switch my stream back over. So this is, most of these are public domain, so you can actually just browse these here. And these are pretty good scans of these. Some of the colors are a little bit off, but they're pretty good. And there is a nice, it's called an elephant folio size edition of these that are printed really nicely. We have a copy in our library you should check out if you like these. But the color is especially interesting to look at because of how rich it is if you look at it physically. If you look through it, I think that you all pointed out several of the ones that I always am kind of drawn to and like to talk about or point out and kind of think about the problems of them. But if you look at this just in terms of the art of comics and what's going on, there are some interesting things you can see as the strip evolves over the years. So if you look at the first couple of ones, I'm just pick this one. Let's take a look at... I like this mushroom one. So if you look at this mushroom one, you can see that there's a few kind of structural elements here that are not going to last forever. So if we were to look at this and then compare it with any contemporary Sunday full-page comic, not that those exist anymore, but any kind of full-page comic, we would probably notice a few things that they have in common and a few that they have that are pretty different. First of all, we have speech bubbles, we have panels, we have gutters between the panels, we have characters being drawn in a stylized way. So we have a lot of the basic artistic elements. We have a few extra things too, though. We have numbered panels. So each of these has a number. Each of these panels also has basically a caption written down here in the gutter between between the rows. So little Nemo had just begun to snooze when he felt the bed tremble slightly, which caused him to immediately investigate. Two, he discovered that while the floor was in place and the bed were, he and the bed were not, and that the usual arrangement was rapidly becoming disarranged. You can see how sometimes he runs out of room. I think he would create the bubble and then try to fit the words in it. And so the lettering is sometimes kind of weird. But, you know, that's okay, I guess. It's basically a lot of text, and you really kind of don't need the text, ultimately. That's I think, what I take away from this, is that the text becomes extra, and especially the kind of caption text between the panels gradually gets less and less, and then eventually is gone entirely. He also even starts, actually, this one's, he's already gotten rid of this, but if you look at, go back. Yeah, early on, he would even do like a whole scene up here in the top, just kind of as part of the title. And then gradually, if it, the that text that is at the bottom of the gutters there, eventually it gets, yeah, you can see here it's quite a lot shorter, just like one line per panel. And then, yeah, then here's where it shifts, so like all of that text, that sort of just exposition explaining what's going on, it just becomes part of the title. So it's up here, and you can see, when the great King Morpheus heard that Nemo could not look at Flip without awakening, he ordered Nemo blindfolded. This only increased the jealousy that lurked in the heart of the bold and bad little Flip. So yeah, and on and on. But that's the that's where the that narration has moved, and then that gradually goes away too, and then we end up just with art and speech bubbles, and that's enough. And that is enough. It should be enough, right? So it's comics. But yeah, there's a lot to enjoy about Winsor McCay's Little Nemo. And again, the artistry really is what I'm continuously drawn to, and really surreal images, really imaginative drawings of architecture in particular. They're really precise. Like, they're just the clarity and precision of his artwork is what makes it so compelling and sometimes so creepy. It's just the narratives are, the storylines are not usually very interesting. There's really just not a lot of, I mean, there is this ongoing conflict with Flip, I guess, but they end up becoming, like, they eventually just decide, hey, let's just hang out together. He does finally meet up with the princess, and then the three of them go do things together. Then they meet other characters. So it's really just like different, almost contrived scenarios to give Winsor McCay an opportunity to draw something really interesting. And that's maybe all there is to it. Maybe that's good enough. But I enjoyed a lot. There's some really striking ones. I'm trying to get to one in particular that I think is coming soon. Almost there, I think. I'm trying to get to this one in particular that I'm thinking of without clicking back to the main browse page, if I can find it. You know, I'm just going to have to go back so I can find it. There's one or two of this, of an elephant, which I find really dramatic and impressive. And these thumbnails are just barely big enough for me to skim them and recognize. There it is. So yeah, check this out. I mean, this is just amazing, right? This gigantic elephant is coming closer and closer and closer and closer to us. And I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of the ways that Winsor McCay organizes a sequence like this, which you can definitely see echoes of this kind of thing in just basic film techniques. The idea of something really large getting closer and closer and closer and closer, like that idea of like editing that as a shot in a film, kind of makes sense. But this is really before that vocabulary of how film shots and counter shots and different montages, this is before all that language had really developed in film itself. And so McCay was developing a kind of visual language here that I think went beyond comics, and that became a template for visual artists working with film soon afterward. So this is 1906 when this was published, right? We don't really have film per se. But this panel, just again, just beautifully drawn. I don't know, some people like to make a lot of the phallic imagery with the trunk of the elephant, but I don't know. That's always a bit... your mileage may vary with Freudian interpretations in general, but I think this one, I can see it here, but it's really just visually, if nothing else, just the expression on the elephant's face and the giganticness of it is really driven home here. And then, yeah, he's still huge and running. And yeah, there's that moon thing again. All right, so Winsor McCay's Little Nemo, I think, is very important, influential, and just kind of fascinating. So let's take a look back over here to this one. A few more things about Winsor McCay I wanted to talk about. So Winsor McCay also did animation, as we talked about. I showed you a bit of Gertie the Dinosaur the other day. This is an earlier one called How a Mosquito Operates from 1912, and this is very much in the Dreams of a Rarebit Fiend modality. And in fact, I think he subtitled it that or published it along that title. But he would show this on a stage in a vaudeville kind of context. This is, like a lot of the Rarebit Fiend stuff, I'm going to say it's more of a horror movie than anything else. It's if you're squeamish about insects, maybe minimize the screen for a minute. But this is a mosquito, and as you can see, it's a rather large mosquito, and we're seeing him perform his operation as he comes in here. So he's going to climb into this guy's room and fly in here. Actually, I do have a mosquito. I mean, there are mosquitoes in this room that I am in right now, and I keep trying to smack them, but they, like, or maybe it's just one mosquito that keeps coming back, but I keep missing it. It's like, because this is like my sunroom, and so I'm sort of outside, and so it's not perfectly sealed off, and so I get mosquitoes in here, and it's very frustrating. Anyway, so this is the mosquito sharpening his thing, and I guess, you know, really, the mosquitoes that bite you are actually females, so this one is kind of coded as male. Not that it really matters, as you'll see. This is a pretty fantastical thing, but even given the fantastical scenario here, this idea of a gigantic mosquito who's personified in various ways. Notice how precise and, like, anatomically precise it is, the way that this mosquito is drawn, with the, you know, the sort of furry head and, like, the jagged proboscis as he starts digging into this guy's nose, and then filling up with blood. Yeah, like I said, this is a horror movie, so let me just kind of skip on a little bit. He keeps coming back and back. This is pretty entertaining to watch all the way through. But you see the blood filling up. You ever do that where, like, you know a mosquito's on you, but you kind of wait for it to get stuck so you can smack it better? This guy missed anyway. He's getting itchy. All right, so let's kind of... I'll just let this play out. As you'll see here, this is not going to end well. He can bite even through the blanket, right? Yeah, this is pretty squicky, as I say. There is music. I mean, this is a silent film, and if you find it on YouTube, you can find different people's musical accompaniment. I don't really like any of them, so, I mean, they're fine, but I think you get the idea just by watching it. Okay, here we go. Like, even the level of detail on the, I guess, abdomen of this mosquito to kind of add that sort of shine dot to make it look globular and shiny is very interesting. Around. Yeah, skip out of it. So the mosquito, he's just kind of showing off now. He's just doing flips on this guy's nose. Just because, you know. He's going to packing up his equipment. Again, showing off a little bit with the with the hat. It's like, so long, folks. It's gonna take one more little bump for the road. Oops, too much. He exploded. And there's blood everywhere. Yeah, so pretty gross, right? And also just really horrifying, like just to kind of set that, you know, to create that sense of like, of being there and experiencing that is pretty intense. Yeah, so anyway, let's take a look then at Gertie. And this is Gertie. I'm actually going to try to bring myself back here for a second. Oh, here I am. Let me just try something. Problem is I have to crop myself. That's not too bad. Okay, there I am. Okay. I don't know if you care, but here I am again. So this is Gertie the dinosaur, and I showed you a bit of this the other day. Not that one yet. And so I don't know if I want to show you the whole thing now, but there's a whole frame story in this case where it's him meeting these cartoonists and, you know, we're going to have this bet. And then you actually get to the animation. I wanted to show you a bit more of the animation. It is surprisingly, it is, you know, she's very like detailed and very realistic in her way, in the way that she's drawn, almost kind of, I guess, voluptuous the way that she's moving around. And you can imagine this being like an interactive thing. And I think this way that she gestures to an audience, like this was literally the case that he would put her on, project this on a stage and then be standing next to her and then saying these things that we see as intertitles here. Like he would literally say these things out loud. So we would see him give her this command and she would act it out. This idea of breaking that fourth wall or there not being a fourth wall is something that you see a lot in his comics. And when he plays with that in the comics, it often becomes a source of anxiety or terror. Here, it's just kind of a whimsical, like kind of a funny idea, the way that she's interacting. And I think in this early day of cinema, there is a bit of magic to it. There's a bit of an illusionist art to this kind of magic, and animation. And if you look at other early animation from the 1910s, some things even earlier, some of them do just have kind of silly little scenarios, but there is a lot that plays on the surrealism of it or the magicalness of it, and a lot of really weird experimental things that we view now as experimental or that would seem very avant-garde now, but that they were just people trying to figure out what to do with this technology in an artistic context. And sometimes you end up with really weird things, like how a mosquito operates. So if you can really go down a rabbit hole on YouTube if you want to look at this, because this is all public domain, so it's very easy to explore a lot of it. And now that it's all on YouTube, it's very easy to explore a lot of it. It used to be you'd have to have, like, for years I had just like a bootleg DVD that I had burned from stuff from a video disc of things like this. But it's pretty good. Let's see. Now she's this part with the elephant. Yeah, this is coming up now. She eats the tree, and just to kind of give you a sense of scale, there's a woolly mammoth is about to walk by, or an elephant, I guess. And she's doing a dance. I don't know if maybe I'll turn the music back on. I don't know how loud that is, but that's the. I actually don't know if you can even hear the music. No, you can't. Try this. Yeah, it doesn't look like the audio is coming through at all. But yeah, you can see she's doing a little dance, and I mean, I like how the Jumbo, the elephant, is like lurking in the lake there, like soon, and he's getting ready to get his revenge. He's just waiting for his opportunity. He's just lurking in the lake. Yeah, she dances for a long time. Look how happy she is. Okay, let's skip ahead a bit. No, it's about to happen. Okay. There it goes. Wah! You got her. And I mean, look at the spray of the water, how you know, detailed that is. And so she chunks a rock at him and does a little bow. Like the way that she rolls over to me just looks like the way a large dog would do that. And it looks very believable, the way that he's able to render her. Yeah, then this thing, flying lizard, goes by and have a little drink, and she's going to drink the lake down. Yeah, and then at the end, yeah, I wanted to get to this part. Yeah, after she's emptied the lake And then McCay would step behind the projector, but as you see, that's him. He steps onto the screen and then is drawn riding Gertie off into their next adventure, I suppose. And then they pay the bet for the dinner. So to back to the frame narrative. Yeah, so just a really fascinating and compelling bit of early animation. So this is another early bit of animation, and this one also has a soundtrack, but I'm not going to play it. I'm not going to show you the whole thing. It's a bit longer. This is propaganda. So this is, I believe it was commissioned by the U.S. Army, but it was definitely something he was asked to do. I forget who commissioned it now. But he is like, there's a frame narrative where he's like, I've got to do something about this. I'm going to use my art to convince people that America needs to get involved in World War One. So there's a similar set of gags with the multiple drawings and like the big stack of paper falling over, kind of silly. But then we actually get to the narrative part of it, where we actually get the depiction and some animation. And I mean, look at the waves. Look how ominous they are, but how realistically rendered they are, right? Going double speed, are we? Yeah, no, okay, good. Yeah, this is only 480p. This is, I mean, these were, it would be nice to have higher resolution, but like these frames were literally like a cup just like this big. So if we were to, we would have to get, I don't know what it would take to remaster this. It would be a pretty interesting challenge archivally, but there may not be a better print of it than what we have here anyway. So 480p is maybe the best we can do. Okay, so here comes the U-boat. And they're like, hey, let's do something. So yeah, they're getting ready to fire the torpedo. I wanted to at least show you the explosion. As I mentioned the other day, this one is, it is disturbing, like some of these. It goes through, like here goes the torpedo. There's some fish that are gonna get startled by it. Basically, it shows lots of people drowning and like falling off the ship and then drowning, including some children. And it's really disturbing. Like, I don't like to watch it, so I'm not going to show you that part. But I want you to see how the smoke, like how liquidy it looks and how like, scary it looks. Like, this is a really frightening set of images. I think he was actually painting this. Like, I think it was actually painted on the pieces of paper. But yeah, just like a really... the way the smoke moves is so realistic. Like, you can tell he really studied how smoke moves, how explosions look, and then it goes down. The ship gradually goes down, basically, and then it kind of gives us a list of important people or well-known people who were on board that died. It's a very sad, very emotional piece of art, but definitely, like I said, it's propaganda. So anyway, so that was there's a lot more to say about Winsor McCay and much more. We could say if we had some time, but I do want to move on to some things. And I see I'm a little bit long on time already, so I'm going to wrap it up here, or very soon anyway. If you have any questions about this stuff or thoughts, discussion, you know, if you want to comment on it, like I do usually do this as a very, yes, and Piper, I will definitely do that. I even lost my train of thought. I just switched to your thing. Here's the next bit of reading. The next thing we're going to look at is a work called The City by Franz Masriel. There are a couple of different versions of it online, and I need to do a little looking to find the better one, maybe I did already put it on Canvas. Let me think. So it's access denied. What? So let me pull it up real quick, and then I'll show you. The issue with The City by Franz Masriel is that it's not, there are no page numbers. So if I ask you to read part of it, I can't say read up to page whatever. I have to literally say read until you see this one. Although if I've already made this as a PDF, I guess the PDF would have pages. So let me just I want to make sure this is the good quality one before I... And this, well, if it ever renders, then I will be able to show you a little bit of this and give you an introduction to it. So this is a wordless graphic narrative by Franz Masriel, and it is a narrative, but it's not like a novel. I want to include it in this class because it is a long-form literary work in graphic format. Whether or not it's a graphic novel is something we could debate, but it has a lot in common with graphic novels. It's also not a comic strip, and I wanted to kind of include things like this that are not comics per se, or the things that we would normally recognize as comics. So interestingly, there were actually a couple other artists working in a similar medium using woodcuts and wordless narratives to tell, like wordless images to tell stories. Lind Ward is an American artist who did a lot. I don't have any PDFs of his work because they're not public domain. Franz Masriel's, though, are public domain, and so I do have some PDFs of his. It's 100 pages. Yeah, here we go. And very much, very stylized, I would say expressionistic in its style as opposed to impressionistic. And it's just images of the city. And we do somewhat follow certain characters, certain points of view throughout this. But it's if anything, a modernist kind of novel. I would compare it structurally to like Joyce's Ulysses in some ways, but not nearly as organized as Ulysses. So it's more like the Wandering Rocks chapter of Ulysses, if anything. So as you look, it is images of the city, and it's kind of the premise, I think, is that it's the city in all of its beauty and ugliness. And there is a lot of ugliness in it, I should warn you about. There is a fair amount of violence, and you can see here this is someone who's died. A lot of the violence is sexual violence. It's not the emphasis of the work, I don't think, but it's definitely something you'll notice as you look through it, and it's something that you may want to talk about. Mainly, I wanted you to be prepared that there is a fair amount of that, or there's several instances of women being attacked, and I don't know. I'm curious to see what you think of it. There are some that seem that could be read different ways because these are images without text. We have to do a lot of the work of interpretation, and so I'm interested in your interpretation of these. So take a look at it. It's only 100 pages, so I think maybe just looking through the whole thing would be fine for Friday, and then we should have some things to talk about with that. Okay, so I will put an announcement, so to answer Piper's question, in Canvas, but that's it, right? So it's looking at that. Let me just add the note here. Yes. All right, great. And so then we'll be moving on. We'll be looking at this Friday and Monday, and then I think we go to Donald Duck next. So that should be a nice change of tone. Okay, so thanks for watching. I hope this was interesting and informative or whatever. So I will be streaming again. Today's Wednesday. I will be streaming again Friday. So I will see you then for that. Otherwise, have a good afternoon and bye.